This week at the Internet Cafe, Hollywood Online. Have you seen Titanic more than once? Then you'll want to visit this website and e-zine all about actor Leonardo DiCaprio. Lucy Mole used to be a movie reviewer on television. Now she reviews movies on the web at a great site called film.com. If you'd like to fantasize about being in the movie business, check out the Hollywood Stock Exchange, a website where you trade in films and actors. Linda Della found she didn't always agree with the movie critics, so she started her own website where you can get personalized movie recommendations. And the winner of the Oscar for Weird Movie website, check out skinema.com, the movies as seen through the eyes of a dermatologist. Hollywood on the web, this week at the Internet Cafe.
The Internet Cafe is brought to you by Z Auction, the live online shopping experience. Additional funding from PC Connection and Mac Connection, the catalog and online superstore with PC and Mac products, toll-free technical support, and overnight delivery. And by Windows Magazine, delivering desktop, enterprise, and internet computing news, reviews, features and how-tos for a Windows world, because the world runs on Windows. Additional funding from SoftSource Incorporated, publishers of Pro One's Mathematics Tutor in a Box for school year 98-99, including 6 CDs and workbook.
So we're doing Hollywood Online, Hollywood on the web, which to some degree, a lot of it's kind of trivial to me. I mean, every movie's got a website.
Hollywood trivial? Come on.
Shallow?
I mean, a movie's got a website, just a big commercial, right? Every single Hollywood actress or actor has about 10 fan sites right now.
Unless you're Pamela Anderson, and then you have about 60,000. Yeah.
What I'm interested in is getting this kind of movie stuff into video rental stores where there's 100,000, 10,000 boxes of tapes there, and it's impossible to find the movie you want. Where is the web? Where's the terminal sitting inside Blockbuster, for example?
Right. I have seen a few stores. There's one, Reel.com, which I think actually started as a website.
Yeah, that's really a website first.
Right, but it is a store, so I think you're probably going to see other places doing that soon.
You've got to have really good imaging. You've got to have great sound. You've got to have a whole bunch of things to make that work.
Well, hopefully we'll get to the day where you can really look at movie clips. So we're going to look at one website tonight, actually, that does have movies online, more than just reviews. So it's not too bad.
Right. I like just kind of going and reading the dirt on the stars. That's the fun
who's
part
for me. Who's
doing
what with whom?
Well,
is
because
that
you know what it is? You get a lot of folks who create their own sites, and they don't have to sort of stand by the same editorial guidelines as a great magazine like People Magazine, and they can print whatever they want.
That's
and
high
so
high.
This guy's way off. All right, we're going to take a look at Hollywood Online tonight at the Internet Cafe. Well, some of the movie sites on the web are for average moviegoers, just like you and me, we go to the movies. Some are for serious cinema folks, and I guess that's more, Lucy, where your site is involved. And you've got serious reviews, serious discussions about the cinema, right? It's not just average stuff.
Well, I think to say it's serious is actually to overstate it, because it's not just one thing that we do with film.com. It was founded by critics, a group of critics I worked with for many, many years. But when we decided to go on the web, the whole point was to bring something broader to the moviegoer than had been there before. So sometimes serious sounds like it's all cinephiles, and you'd have to haul out a big tome out of a library in order to understand what we're talking about. But that's not what we're saying. We were saying the audience is really interested in movies.
Sure, but it's going beyond just the simple reviews you're going to see in a lot of places, right? I mean, there's intelligent discussion about movies and what they mean and why they're good and why they're bad. Mm-hmm. You've got interviews with filmmakers and so on, right? So it's a lot deeper than just reviews is what I was trying to get at.
Yeah, I think that's quite true. We're trying to bring some breadth to it. And one of the hallmarks of the site is we have multiple critics for nearly every film.
Thank goodness.
So if you don't like one opinion, you go to the next one.
Now, your background is, I mean, you're a movie critic, right? So, I mean, this is where it's all started. Yeah. I mean, what is your background of that?
I'm sorry?
What is your background?
Well, as a movie critic, actually, I'm sort of in the womb movie critic, because my mother was also a critic.
Oh, wow.
So second generation,
she took
I grew
you
up
there,
with
right?
it. Yeah. But I didn't really ever start out thinking I could make a living as a film critic, but as it happened, I stumbled into that career path, was there for many years.
Now, there's a lot of interesting stuff on your site besides just the reviews and interviews. Number one is you have a screening room.
Mm-hmm.
You can actually look at movie clips up there. Explain that part of it.
This is one of the great features of the site. You can come in and look at movies, and that means a really broad spectrum of movies already. We have a lot of feature film trailers and clips from popular films.
So it's previews, coming attractions.
Exactly.
And actual full-length short films that people produce, right?
Exactly. Midnight Theaters, full-length independent short films that we've just been able to launch recently. And we have other shorts that are due out because you realize, you know, shorts have no place to be seen.
Exactly. Except on the web.
Except on the web. We think we've opened up some potential for a new audience to discover what's going on in short films, some of which are just fantastic.
Yeah. And you're using Real Player, right? Real Networks for that?
Of course. We're a Real Networks company.
Oh, are you? I didn't realize that. Okay. Well, of course. And it's a good way to do. But there's other stuff. You've got the screening room. You've got the reviews and the interviews and stuff. You also have interesting chat rooms where people really get into it about why they like or don't like the movie.
One of the things that I've loved about the site from the very beginning, it was really an accident that I started putting in the discussion board area.
Yeah.
I always knew that when I saw a movie and I walked out of the theater afterwards, I was just dying to talk about it with my friends.
Exactly.
So we'd go out and have a cup of coffee, and I started thinking, isn't that something that we can bring to the party?
Yeah.
So we started the discussion rooms, and before I knew it, they had just taken off crazy.
Now, you've gone one step further. You have limerick contests? What's this about?
We decided we had to do something new for the Oscars because everybody does the same old, same old.
Right.
So we decided that what would we do that would be both a challenge and entertaining for our audience? So we put out a limerick contest.
It's still going, I guess.
It's still going very strong.
Now, the other thing you have, which I actually like, which you have a store on the site where you can buy stuff for Movie Bus, right? What kind of stuff do you sell there?
It's a really interesting store concept because it's not the all things to all moviegoers.
Right.
What we tried to do with it is isolate things that we think people will really find interesting, specialty items, rare.
Well, exactly. You had the screenwriting software, which is great. You had the book on how to go sell your screenplay.
Yeah.
I mean, again, stuff for people who are really into the movies.
And when you look at the screening room, you realize, too, that there's another avenue to find interesting things if you want to buy them, because we have a home video theater. Right now it's specializing in science fiction, but we're having a lot of different alternative and cult categories coming along, and people can buy video that way.
It's a great site, film.com. Thanks, Lucy.
Thanks.
For URLs of today's featured websites, check out the Internet Cafe site at cmptv.com.
So we're talking about Hollywood, and I don't think there's a hotter star right now than Leonardo DiCaprio.
He is hot.
You have the job for Yahoo of actually being the one who goes out and categorizes the Leonardo DiCaprio sites, among other things.
I can't imagine
that's all you're doing. So what kind of sites are you seeing out there right now?
Well, we see a lot of everything. Everything from a page that looks like a third grader put it together to these incredibly professional, slick, published sites that really look like they might be official, but they're not.
All about Leonardo.
All about Leonardo DiCaprio.
How many sites would you estimate are out there, or at least have you guys categorized right now?
At least 40 or 50, I would think. And there's going to be a lot more. And then you also find, you may not call it a Leonardo DiCaprio page per se, but someone has their home page and they say, here are my interests. I love Leonardo. He's my favorite. And then they have a picture of him.
But
I'm not sure I'd call that a site.
Right.
But there's lots and lots of stuff being devoted to Leonardo right now.
Now, I went last night, surfed a little bit, found some of these sites, and I'm amazed at the passion that people put into some of these sites. And these are, mostly unofficial sites.
Yeah.
What are a couple of sites that you think stand out of the unofficial sites?
Well, the definitive starting point is DiCaprio.com, and that's the completely unofficial Leonardo DiCaprio homepage.
So someone owns that domain, DiCaprio.com, and it's not Leonardo. And
it's not Leonardo. And actually, that's a whole separate issue worth an interesting debate, is what happens if someone publishes a site with your name.
Right.
But this is a real traditional type of a fan site. So you're going to find like a full filmography and news and information and biographical material and all kinds of hot news, you know, where Leo's popping up, Leo's spottings. He was seen in southern Florida. He was seen here. He was seen there.
So real fan based stuff. Now, why do people do this? What's the motivation?
Why do people do this?
Right.
Well, for one thing, the web is an incredibly easy medium to publish on.
Mm-hmm.
So there's very few barriers to entry.
Right.
So if you think back to the old days, people used to put together these zines, like stapled magazine pages. And now on the web, it's so much easier to do. So I think that helps a lot. And
they have a lot of time on their hands.
They have a lot of time on their hands. They must have a lot of time. Some of these sites are so incredible.
Passion.
So, and it's really the passion. It's got to be. It's got to be the passion and the love. And it just spurns them to spend all day, you know, here's my new Leonardo pictures, I found this news story, you know. So.
Now, there's an interesting phenomenon that seems to happen, is that it's not always the most famous star that has the most sites on the web.
Yeah.
I think we've seen some examples like that. The X-Files, which is a very popular show, mm-hmm. but I don't mm-hmm. think the folks on that show are as famous as, say, some of the major stars like Mel Gibson.
Yeah,
but
or like Xena and Hercules.
Right, exactly.
Well, the web seems to attract kind of a bizarre crowd anyway.
Okay.
So I think a lot
Can
of these people...
Can you define that bizarre crowd?
Jeez. Just real real geeks, uh-huh. you know? So I think a lot of these people bring their passion online, so you'll find a lot of material devoted to kind of off stars like Xena.
Right.
And,
science fiction, maybe more
definitely. I mean, science
Dungeons
fiction,
and Dragons
absolutely.
Type characters,
absolutely.
Sort of what the web yeah. maybe was founded
absolutely.
On in the first place. Okay, now what about fan sites that are actually not fan sites, but
yeah.
anti-fan sites?
This is sort of a recent phenomenon, at least mm-hmm. to me it seems more or less like a recent phenomenon. And I guess it's very much the same things that compel someone to publish a fan site.
Mm-hmm.
You know, well, this person, you know what, he hates Leonardo DiCaprio. Maybe his girlfriend broke up with him because she liked Leo or something.
Right.
But so now he's devoted all his time to what he doesn't like about Leonardo
so it's
DiCaprio.
The anti-fan site.
Especially
okay.
with Spice Girls and Hanson and all
people
these kind
hate
of
those
mainstream phenomena.
Well.
People just love
right.
to tear those apart.
Okay, in a second, can you tell us how to get to these DiCaprio entertainment sites on Yahoo?
You can just type DiCaprio and you'll get a category full of all the sites that we list for him.
Thank you. Well, thank you.
My pleasure.
For URLs of today's featured websites, check out the Internet Cafe site at cmptv.com.
Well, I went to your website, I got to tell you, that moviecritic.com, and I was impressed. It's just what I want. It
Great.
Tells me what movies I like. I don't have to depend on these jerky reviewers who don't agree with me. What, for people who haven't been to the site yet, explain really what goes on there. What is the point in moviecritic.com?
Okay. Well, it's a place where anyone can go to get movie recommendations, and they're all personalized to your tastes. And it works by using a technology called collaborative filtering, which we have developed internally. The idea is that you can go to the Movie Critic, go to the lobby page, and you're asked to register and rate about 12 movies.
Mm-hmm.
So what we're doing is collecting your movie tastes. And then the technology goes into a database, and there's about 100,000 people in our database, and it looks for people who are just like you. So as it goes through, it finds people who are like you, and it creates a pool of mentors, we call them.
Yeah.
And then it looks at the mentor pool and decides what it should recommend back to you.
All right, now how does this work? I mean, what does that mean, people like me? How does this all happen?
Well, there's really two things it's looking for. It's looking for people who have seen the same movies that you've seen.
Yeah.
And also for people who rated them similarly.
Okay.
And it basically ranks these people and creates a cluster around you so that you are the center of a cluster of people who have very, very similar tastes and preferences.
And if they got to see a movie before I got to see it, I benefit from their point of view.
Exactly.
Because I'm going to anticipate, you're going to anticipate that they'll agree with me.
Right, exactly. It's kind of one of the beauties of the web because it allows people to interact without actually being in the same place and time.
All right, now you've got something called the Like Minds engine underneath all of that. Mm-hmm. What's the sort of technology secret here?
Well, it's a software technology secret. It's actually patented. The technology was patented in the late 80s, and it's a technology called collaborative filtering. And it basically does that process. It looks for people who are like you, and it builds a what we call prediction vector, which
mm-hmm.
is a fancy way of saying it goes through a lot of statistical calculations and makes a prediction specifically for you.
Yeah, and it does it pretty darn quick. I mean, I went on there and
yes.
boom, 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 it says, here's the movies you should go see. Now, what does it recommend besides new releases? Are
mm-hmm.
there video rentals and classics, other kinds of things
yes,
up there?
Yes, yes. You can basically ask for new releases, for movies on video, and for movies and classics. But you can also filter that by what we call genre filtering.
Okay, so action, sci-fi,
right,
whatever.
You're in the movie for a comedy tonight, so you can go just
now,
get a comedy.
What about the problem that you have a spouse or a significant other and you have slightly different tastes and you're trying to find a movie you won't yell at each other about that you'll both enjoy? How do you go about doing that? You do that, don't you?
Yes, we have a special feature called Movies for Two.
Right.
And all you have to do is put in your name and put in your spouse or the person you're going out with, their name and their our technology knows their preferences.
Right.
And then it creates what we call a composite person, which is basically your taste married with their taste,
right.
and makes a movie recommendation for the two of you.
Does it end up being all like, you know, lowest common Disney movies or something?
No. It really does go through and find movies that will appeal to both of you.
All right, now this Like Minds engine, it sounds pretty cool. Is that, I would assume you want to use that in other things besides just movies, right?
Yes. In fact, that's what Like Minds is doing. We're commercializing this technology to use it in other spaces and places. For example, Columbia House is now using it in their website called Total E,
mm-hmm.
And against movie and music recommendations. And they're going to be using it against book recommendations as well.
Right, now, finally, can I get to meet these people in my group? Because that's a pretty good index of who you're going to get along with.
You know, unfortunately, you cannot meet those people because the premise is all that it's anonymous.
All right.
That these people are mentors to you, but we don't really introduce you to those people.
That'll be coming soon.
Right.
Thanks a lot.
The new dating service.
Thank you, Linda.
For URLs of today's featured websites, check out the Internet Cafe site at cmptv.com.
So, Dr. Reese, this is an unusual site, a movie site combined with a dermatological site. How did you get started with this?
Well, I've always been a fan of film and theater, and I've done some work in video in the past, and I really love my job as a dermatologist. And so a few years ago, while I was still doing my dermatology training, I actually started with one example that dermatologists have used for years, which is W.C. Fields. He has a form of adult acne, and that's what caused his large bulbous nose, not just the alcohol, but really this form of acne called acne rosacea. And based on that example, I really started to explore what other examples of skin conditions can be found in movies, and there are a lot.
There's lots.
Yeah.
Now, typically when I think of actors or movies where they've got skin problems, I typically think that that's always the bad guy. He's got the scar down his face, you know, Scarface, Al Pacino, the whole nine yards.
Of course.
Is that pretty much what you found with the movies as well?
Yeah, very, very predominantly, if you have a character as a skin condition, not invariably, but mainly you'll see that they're an evil character and the skin condition is being used to basically delineate them as evil. So you get people with albinism who are evil and scarring and big moles.
Tattoos all over the body.
And tattoos, and it goes on and on and on. It almost becomes a cliche when you really start to think about it. What I like to do with my site is let people know that not everybody with albinism is evil. And it sounds like a simple thought, but I think subconsciously when people see movies, they lose sight of that simple fact.
No, I think albino, I think of Powder, and he was a good guy.
He wasn't a normal guy.
No.
He was a weird, magical guy. And people with albinism are just like other people. They just don't have the pigmentation that the rest of us have.
So now what about the other side of the coin? What about actors, movies where you've got skin problems where they're actually good guys? They're not depicted as evil. Do you have any examples of that?
Yeah, and if it's a main character, it's usually Oscar-bound. Because it will be something like The English Patient, where Ralph Fiennes' character covered burn scars, and he wasn't evil. He was a kind of a complex, interesting character.
But he was also the good-looking guy earlier on, so you did get to see what he used to look like, too.
True, that's a good point. And you'll see things, like Mel Gibson did a movie, The Man Without a Face, where he was scarring.
Was that accurate, do you think? The depiction of his scars?
No question, yeah. Burn scars, very realistically done. The other one that comes to mind is Tom Hanks in the film Philadelphia. Had the KS lesions that you can get in HIV disease, but otherwise was a sympathetic character, was not a stereotypical evil character.
So now what other things can I find at your site? I can get some pictures and some stories about various movies and evil depictions and positive depictions, but what other things do you have?
I've got a lot of things. We have some discussion sections, the freeze frame section, where I basically start with the discussion of a skin condition and really move on to a lot of other social and psychosocial issues. We also have spotlights where I'll highlight a specific film or series. The James Bond series, for example, has a lot of skin conditions, most of them evil characters. Or the film Blade Runner from the early 80s has a whole number of skin conditions.
Yeah.
So that's fun little spotlight.
So what kind of response have you had from the public visiting your site?
Really very favorable. Most people learn something from the site, but are also entertained by it too, and that's certainly been my goal. Not just to educate, but to do it in kind of a interesting and innovative way.
I thought it was really interesting. There was one section that you had where you posed the issue of Michael Jackson's proposed skin problem.
Right.
And I couldn't believe the wealth of responses that you had from, you know, yes, he's really got it, to no, this guy's full of it, there's nothing wrong at all. It's incredible.
Like Michael Jackson really engenders passion. Some people are very, very excited and into Michael Jackson, and other people are much more wary. And my goal with that discussion is really to make people think more about vitiligo, which Michael Jackson may or may not actually have.
But it's a great forum, that's for sure.
It's been really interesting.
It's a great site, won
Thank
lots
you.
Of awards,
Thank
and
you.
I'm looking forward to seeing all the new stuff that you're going to have there, too.
Fantastic.
For URLs of today's featured websites, check out the Internet Cafe site at cmptv.com.
So, Max, you came up with this idea of the Hollywood Stock Exchange, HSX.com. What is it? How does it work?
Stewart, it's a chance for you to own Hollywood. I don't mean real estate Hollywood. I don't mean the corporations who run Hollywood, but actually Hollywood itself. You can own the movies. You can own the actors in a
make
portfolio.
Money off them.
Yeah, you trade.
How do I do that?
Okay, we give you $2 million Hollywood dollars.
Okay.
As you come to HSX.com.
Like Monopoly money.
Exactly.
Okay.
Then you go down to the stock market, the Hollywood stock market, Hollywood Stock Exchange.
And I can invest
and
in
movie stocks, which are actual
movies.
Real movies like Godzilla, Lethal Weapon 4.
Okay.
Movies that are going to be opening in the next month, months, 9 months,
so
next year.
So I can invest
year.
In movies.
Correct.
And
actors. And actors take the form of bonds, star bonds. So Alec
right.
Baldwin, Kim Basinger, Mel Gibson. Their bonds trade on the how well their movies are going to do in the next 6 months or 1 year.
Okay, so now how does the value work? How do we know what Godzilla is going to be worth, what Kim Basinger is going to be worth?
Sure, just like the overall U.S. economy is based on this cash flow that comes in through all these corporations, the Hollywood Stock Exchange is based on all the box office revenues. So all the securities
are tied. Sort of like Fantasy League Baseball. I mean, there's statistics underlying all this, how much money these people make.
Absolutely. There's a very strong statistical underlying element to the exchange, but it's like Fantasy Baseball on steroids,
okay.
And then you have the addition of all these thousands of traders who are creating a stock market and a virtual stock market where the value is based on anticipation as
right.
well as the hard facts.
So everybody isn't running out there going after Julia Roberts and all the biggies because those values are already high, right? They're looking
correct.
For the little guys who are going to become big stars later?
Exactly. You got it, Stuart. Those high price like Julia Roberts, the bonds are
it's too late
high,
to buy her.
Too late.
All right.
But Leonardo DiCaprio,
get
3 months ago,
sell high. There you go.
Was a huge bargain. And he's
that's
tripled
right.
in the last 9 months.
All right, now how rational is this market? Are there, you know, technical factors like you might find on the real stock exchange?
It's about five times more rational than the New York Stock Exchange.
I wonder how much that's saying, but no. It really is based on performance and.
Absolutely, it's a very rational market because the central technology, if you will, is the virtual specialist, which
uh-huh.
handles up to 90 million shares a day and makes markets.
That's your software.
That's correct.
Okay.
And it makes market in hundreds of these securities. And it matches buys and sells, so there's supply and demand based on anticipation for what the box office is going to be, plus, as you point out, the underlying statistical
okay.
intrinsic value.
But I understand there was a kind of a crash on your market. I mean, what caused that?
Well, just like the real market
yeah.
or the New York Stock Exchange market, there's an economy at work.
Right.
And just like the United States economy, there's the Federal Reserve Bank and Alan Greenspan. We have Dr. Zeros.
You're Alan Greenspan.
No. No, this Dr. Zeros
right.
is the chairman of our Hollywood Reserve Bank.
Okay, so if the value of the market gets too high, he says inflation or whatever?
He can raise interest rates. He can lower interest rates.
Okay.
He can add money. He can take money out because he is managing this almost $200 billion economy.
Now, do I get daily quotes like I would on the stock market?
You get
instant
quotes.
What my movie's worth, what my actor's worth?
Continuous quotes, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week.
Now, do the real guys in Hollywood pay attention to what the perceived value is on HSX?
More and more, absolutely.
I would think so.
Sure, a movie like Godzilla has been tracking very, very well, whereas a movie like Lethal Weapon 4,
yeah.
which is an Mel Gibson movie, is already not showing a lot of capital is attracted to it. So executives in Hollywood know, just like last summer, it was
right.
Batman 3 didn't do as well as Men in Black. But in our exchange, Men in Black was up hugely months before the summer because the market of people who are going to buy that ticket.
Not just the game necessarily then, huh? I mean, people are getting a feel for what the market thinks about things.
It's no less of a game than the New York Stock Exchange.
Right.
I'll give you another example.
Yeah.
I have a trader in London who trades financial futures, who tracks the price of Godzilla, the movie stock on HSX,
yeah.
and helps him determine which way the Nikkei Stock Exchange
that's
is
amazing.
Going in Tokyo.
HSX.com. Thank you, Max.
Thank you, Stuart.
Well, as so often happens during this program, I got convinced. I mean, I wasn't really too big on this Hollywood stuff at the beginning, but I saw great websites. MovieCritic.com, I thought was terrific. Film.com, a great film magazine online, mm-hmm. really an e-zine about movies, lots of cool stuff. And HSX, Hollywood Stock Exchange, you got to check this stuff out. I mean,
yeah.
really fun trading in movies and making money off stars. It's just a neat
right.
online, the kind of thing you could only do online, right?
Yep. Well, I didn't need to be convinced about Hollywood. I've always been someone who's been very
Star
interested
teacher.
In, yeah.
People magazine reader.
Yeah, exactly. I kind of like that stuff. And what's fun about the web is a couple things. One is that fans get to put up their own information, and, you know, they don't have to quite follow the same editorial guidelines as
say
a
whatever
magazine.
They want.
They can say whatever
love
they want,
right
or
in.
They can find all kinds of rumors and gossip and put it up there.
Well, there's the anti-fans.
And that's
right?
the other thing that's very strange. There was actually quite a few anti-Leonardo DiCaprio sites. There was actually one called Leonardo DiCaprio Must Die. Okay, now that's kind of scary. But
jealous
it was,
guy.
Well, it was these funny pictures that were doctored and, you know, had knives. And it was someone who really didn't like him.
It's so, people who want to talk to each other about stuff and movies. Exactly. Everybody's into it, so it's a way to do it.
Yeah. Skinema was great. I loved it. You're looking at me strangely. It was great. I mean, it's
skin
stories
diseases
about
online.
How people are depicted and using skin diseases. And I was so fascinated by it that I ended up going to these other dermatology sites, getting more information.
Not other
about
Hollywood
skin problems.
Sites, but dermatology
sites.
Oh,
no, it just kind of opened up my world. It was neat.
I thought your skin was looking nice.
Thank you. I pride myself.
So you really like the gossip bit.
Yeah.
I like going online and finding out what movie is worth seeing, because a lot of them are. Anyhow, that's it. We're at CyberSmith, finishing up Internet Cafe. We'll see you here again next week.
The Internet Cafe is brought to you by Z Auction, the live online shopping experience. Additional funding from PC Connection and Mac Connection, the catalog and online superstore with PC and Mac products, toll-free technical support, and overnight delivery. And by Windows Magazine, delivering desktop, enterprise, and internet computing news, reviews, features, and how-tos for a Windows world, because the world runs on Windows. Additional funding from SoftSource Incorporated, publishers of Pro One Software, educational software for young adults. To purchase a videotape copy of today's program, call toll-free 1-888-310-7850. Please specify the show number and the topic.
To ensure the continuation of our way of life, we've been preparing a network of immense caves, and we can put a million people in them, underground, for 2 years. On August 10th, we're going to hold a national lottery. A computer will randomly select 800,000 Americans to join the 200,000 scientists, teachers, soldiers, and artists who have already been chosen. In addition, the United States and Russia have been building the largest spaceship ever constructed to stop the comet.